And on the phone is U.S. Senator Cindy Hyde-Smith. Reminds me of the old days when we were doing this on impeachment. Good morning, ma'am. How are you?
We're good. We're not on impeachment, but boy, we dove off a cliff, I assure you.
I'm telling you, did you make it back home?
I did. Yesterday, we voted around a little before midnight, and I got to the airport. I mean, I had to leave at 3, got up at 3, got a flight into Dallas, and then a flight into Jackson. So, the flights are just so crazy.
I was going to say, how's it very limited? You've as a U.S. Senator, you're getting enough frequent flyer miles. How's it changed because of all of this? As far as the amount of people there, the reaction on a plane, how's it changed?
Oh, you can separate. You know, you're not close to anybody because, you know, the last thing you want to do right now is get on an airplane.
I know.
I took my sanitation wipes, wiped down the seat, wiped down the vents that the air is coming out of, and I had on a mask, I had on gloves, and as most everybody on the plane did. I think there was maybe 7 or 8 people from the Dallas to Jackson flight.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Did you see the picture of the two pilots who were they were pulled into and they had the into the airport, but apparently somebody sneezed. They landed the plane and they climbed out the window. Both of the pilots climbed out the window to escape.
Top Gun.
Oh, man. People are very sensitive about that. I have one message here. And a question to Caleb and Olive Branch said, please make sure you tell Senator Cindy Hyde-Smith thank you. She was there for every roll call that I saw this week on the Senate floor. She's the mover and shaker we've needed for a long time. Thank you, Mr. Gallo. Well, I did pass that on, Caleb. So.
Oh, wow. And, you know, I did, Paul. One of the things I was thinking this morning is I have gotten so many text messages, letters of encouragement, and that really helps when, you know, we didn't even sleep the night before. You know, we voted and then it was time to pack and get on an airplane. You know, we didn't even go to bed, but it's really helped. And the people in Mississippi are so kind anyway.
Yes,
but
they are.
I just want to say I appreciate all of the support I got from back home because, you know, the size and scope of this bill, it was just so remarkable. I mean, nothing like it has ever passed Congress before, ever in our nation's history, that, you know, at this magnitude. So we faced with a lot of challenges. I mean, I've said before, we've had two viruses. We have a medical virus and we have an economic virus. But, you got to just keep your calm, go through this, go through the four packages, and you have to work and work and work till you get it massaged to where, you know, people can agree to. And it was extremely contentious.
So they got some stuff in there that you didn't want, and you probably got some stuff in there that they didn't want, meaning Republican and Democrat. We heard about the Kennedy Center and things such as that. But this shows my ignorance as far as economics. But I was in a discussion yesterday and talking to somebody because they were worried about the national debt and all of that, and I understand it. But I said, maybe you could answer this question, is $2 trillion, if we took $2 trillion out and gave it back to the people, what's the difference of that $2 trillion being used by the politicians to put into other places, into pet projects? I mean, you see what I mean? The money is going back into to be spent by the taxpayers themselves at a time when it's absolutely positively needed.
Absolutely. I mean, 100% necessary. It's not a perfect bill, but it was totally necessary for this country to get this infusion back into it. And it is so frustrating when they come up with things of, why don't we include the post office in this? Yeah. You know, the debt that they include. Why don't we put $10,000 on every student loan in the country? And, you know, to have to sit there and most people, you know, most of us in there, we usually have pretty strong backbones or we wouldn't be there. And to refrain and know that, you know, this soldier's got to live to fight another day and to try to not rip into them and tear their heads off and just say, this is not going to happen. Yeah. We're going to stand firm. You know, we're going to massage this bill that it doesn't have ridiculous things that have nothing to do with the event that we're facing, and to continuously say that over and over. But that's what we had to do. Mm-hmm. And the bill that we could have voted on Sunday night and the bill that we eventually voted on Wednesday night, there's so little difference in it. It really is insignificant.
The reason
come out and take credit for all this stuff.
That's exactly
had nothing
right.
to do with.
That's the reason they did that. And Nancy Pelosi can come back and say now, well, I came, I saw, I conquered, I changed it. It's all good now, and you better thank me. But Michael Guest was supposed to be on right before you, and he texted me this morning, and he couldn't make it because he's back on a flight to Washington because of apparently Representative Massey, who is from Kentucky, a Republican. And their rules, I think, are a little bit different than yours, but I'm not sure. But they can't do a voice vote if at least one member says that he doesn't want to. He wants it on record. Apparently Massey says he wants it on record. So everybody, if they were out of town, had to fly back to Washington to get this vote done.
Yeah, for one person.
One person.
We could normally do it by what we call unanimous consent. Everybody just refers to it. We're going to UC it. But within that position, when you don't have everybody there, and, you know, AOC had threatened to object, but one person, you know, can object, and it kills everything. So it would have been so much easier had we just stayed to the original plan when we first realized that, you know, we are going to have to deliver something and for it to go on over there. But it's just nothing is ever easy in the House. Nothing.
Perez,
and to think the cost of flying all of them back up.
Yeah. Did you get that question from Joe Harris?
Joe Harris, yeah. His question was something about overlays and the self-employed and the bill is going to screw up the way things are done as far as mortgages goes, was his complaint.
Yeah.
So by the way, he's a lender, so.
Yeah,
and I'm not sure exactly what he's referring to, but yes, there's going to be issues in there that we're going to have to go back and address, and that's probably a good mm-hmm. example of that. But basically, the small businesses, what most people are interested in right now is making payroll, making their mortgage and rent, and their utility bills. But we simplified it, and, you know, to go through the process of, okay, which agency would we go through to do this to get it the fastest? Mm-hmm. What we figured out with the help of so much of the banking and financial institutions was if we let any bank in the country, any bank, any credit union, a financial institution in any hometown that you can walk in there, and it's the SBA 7A loan, you can apply for that instantly, and we're hoping within 36 hours. Now, that being said, we know the kinks that can go into that, but we're hoping 36 hours that small business owner mm-hmm. can come out with the money to pay their payroll and meet that mortgage and rent and their utilities. And there's some other things included in that with special circumstances, but basically to keep these businesses running and to make sure, you know, that they don't lay people off. And there's so many nuances that if they, you know, did lay them off last week or when we didn't vote on Monday and said, okay, guys, no, nobody has a job, you can bring them back in mm-hmm. instead of putting them on unemployment. Continue as you are, making that same payroll that they made the week before instead of going on an employment situation that it takes so much longer for them to get their
yeah.
money.
So this is
the fastest way.
Did the loan forgiveness for the small business, did that stay in there if they don't fire anybody or lay them off?
But like if they had a previous SBA loan before yeah. this started?
Well, my understanding was if they had a loan and, a new loan. If they had a new loan, it may not have been SBA. It could have been any other ones. If uh-huh. they got a loan, it would turn into a grant if they did not fire anybody. I'm catching you cold on a lot of these things, and it's
yeah.
one of those deals that you just got to read it because it's a lot in there. And even if you read it, as you said, there's going to be some things changed and modified. Look, thank you for calling. I know it's been hectic. And anytime you need us, please get back with us and we'll put you on.
Anytime I can get information out, that is great.
You got it.
But we are, you know, my office is getting a lot of calls, no doubt. We're fielding those calls, but because everybody wants to know when their $1,200 check will be there,
yep.
$2,400 for married couples and those things. But that's probably the first or second week of April, maybe even the third week of April. So.
Senator, U.S. Senator Cindy Hyde-Smith, thank you so very, very much, and we'll talk to you later.